that project here, 12:15 on November 11th. Lunch will be provided, and you are all welcome to come. Well, let me now introduce the moderator for today's panel, who will in turn introduce our really amazing speakers. Bruce Thalen is a partner at Dickinson Wright, one of the leading practitioners of international transactions in the state of Michigan, and most importantly, a member of the advisory board to the Wayne Program for International Legal Studies. And it's a real pleasure to have him run these proceedings. So thank you very much, Bruce.
As Professor Fox said, we have a great panel today. I'm really pleased to have the opportunity to meet them. I've already asked them a bunch of questions, you know, and so I hope that all of you will have some too. We're going to have plenty of time for that as we get going. But let me just give you some quick introductions of our panelists, and we'll get started to hear what they have to say. I think the way we're going to do this is they're each going to make a presentation. We're covering the Middle East, we're covering China, we're covering India. And then we're going to have kind of time for open discussion and questions and things like that. So make your notes and think about things that you might want to talk about, and we'll cover that before we finish. First up is going to be Michael McMillan. We had a governor named Milliken. You'll accept my apologies for that. He's a partner at Curtis Mallet Prevost Colt and Bozell in New York City. He has practiced and is going to speak about issues in the Middle East. He's really an internationally known expert in Islamic financing. And I should say as well, he's also a medical doctor. After getting his law degree and practicing, he went to medical school, and I think we're going to keep our questions to the legal area today. So delighted to have Michael with us. Also, Vivian Wu is here. She is a lawyer with Baker & McKenzie, normally based in Beijing, but is here on a six-month stint in Washington, D.C., so we're really pleased that she was able to come over to be with us today. She's done a lot of work in the corporate and M&A area, but with the focus now on compliance or corrupt practices and various issues like that, she has been devoting a lot of time more recently to matters of compliance, and we'll get into some of those issues as we proceed. And then thirdly, we're delighted to have Gurinder Singh with us. Gurinder is actually a graduate of Wayne Law School, and I think so. You have an alumnus here, an alumna here. Delighted to have her, but she has experience. Previously, she's worked at Ford Motor Company, so she has an industrial background from that experience, and has practiced with a law firm here in Detroit, Miller Canfield, and is now establishing her own firm. She's based in New York, but expects to establish her firm here in the Detroit area. So, and she will speak about issues related to India. So without further ado, I want to kick this over to Mr. McMillan, and he's going to speak to us for a bit about issues in the Middle East.
Thank you very much, Bruce. And you, Craig, and everybody, Rachel, and everybody on the International Law Program. I'm honored to be here. Thank you for coming. I'm going to do Middle Eastern matters here. I'm going to try and give you a little bit of an overview of doing business back and forth with the Middle East. So it'll be very summary, pick a few topics and try and cover. So just primary areas, investment into North America in particular, from the Middle East, and in business transactions in the Middle East involving North American entities of different types. So three areas of investment, beginning business in the U.S. And I'll say this at the beginning, if you take out of the equation Sukuk, which are said to be Islamic bonds, they aren't actually bonds, they're securitization structures. But if you take those out of the equation, in my view, I don't have hard figures on this, but the United States is the second largest Sharia compliant financing jurisdiction in the world. Malaysia's first. But we do tons and tons of work here. Money coming into the U.S. from the Middle East. Real estate, private equity, and Sukuk purchases are the three primary areas of activity. Real estate has long been the primary. Private equity is down a bit since 2008. There's some, there's a huge pickup right now in real estate. It's commercial office buildings, many of the condominiums in Florida after the hurricanes were built with Sharia compliant financing arrangements coming from the Middle East. Two types of financing, conventional and Sharia compliant. Until around 2000, late 1999 or 2000, everything was conventional. Now, the tendency is for everything to be Sharia compliant because of our structures. We'll look at that in a second. The Sukuk are purchased by large insurance companies, pension funds in the United States. They look at them essentially as bond structures, and they match fund to their pension obligations. So probably half of all the big international Sukuk issuances are purchased in the United States, which is an enormous amount of money. Real estate began with residential, and for some Sharia reasons, evolved. The Sharia reason is this: if you have a business as a tenant in a building, they have to be in a Sharia compliant business. Alcohol, pork, interest-based banking, that sort of thing. Basically, the standards of ethical investing that are used by Wisconsin Research Foundation or University of California, Berkeley, those same criteria except for pork and interest. Big increase in the late 1990s when the structures were developed. This is the basic structure for this, so you have some idea. This was developed in order to involve Western entities. So that funding company is an SPV, buys the asset and leases it to the Sharia compliant side of the deal. Because we don't have any Islamic banks in the United States, they provide conventional financing for the asset acquisition. And you'll see that this is the most predominant or dominant structure in the world, a Sharia compliant structure. And it's easy in the United States. I frequently say U.S. is the easiest place in the world to do a Sharia compliant financing. Why? Because our tax system. That funding company is subject to what we call check-the-box regulations, and you can treat it as a disregarded entity so you don't get double taxation. Every other country in the world, England for example, that's their largest problem, is that double taxation. The rent gets taxed as income, where it's really just a repayment of principal and interest if you look at this as a loan. So the equity and the lease rents, let's quickly go through this. The rent pays the debt service. And it's to the penny in the United States equal to the debt service. It's being paid up to the bank. Private equity slowed a great deal, but it's we own all the Cargill buildings in the United States. We leased it back to Cargill. We own Lowman's. We own all the Sunrise nursing homes in Sharia compliant funds. We own probably half of all the Prologis warehouses in the United States. Thomson Reuters headquarters all around Boston. It's just massive. It's Kohl's stores, various computer companies that we, their sale and leaseback transactions. But it's massive business in the U.S. We own actually three or four buildings here in Detroit in some Sharia compliant funds. So it's virtually everywhere. Slowed down a great deal, as I say. Structure is basically the same lease structure, except get some assets over to the mining company, usually push intellectual property or some similar asset there to create the lease arrangement. But otherwise, the structure is basically the same. Sukuk, which are said to be bonds, are really securitizations of either a pool of asset or one asset or whole business securitizations of the type they do in Europe more frequently than the United States. This is the largest growing and dominant sector of Islamic finance right now. So, I don't know if you noticed last month, Goldman Sachs issued a Sukuk, GE has issued a Sukuk. The United States is just starting to get involved. We're starting to do a $10 billion issuance for a U.S. company just now. First billion and a half of them probably come out in December. I think this has the greatest potential of all areas for U.S. businesses. You tell me when there's 2 minutes. Okay, what happens into the Middle East from the U.S., particularly Canada as well, by the way? Oil and gas, petrochemicals, that's most of the investment. So the big oil companies and petrochemical companies have facilities around the Middle East. Up until around 96 or 97, they were all conventionally financed. Now, probably half or more of them are Sharia compliant financing, mostly because the governments in the Middle East prefer Sharia compliant financing. You take a country like Saudi Arabia, which is bigger than all the rest of the Middle East combined, huge amount of money. They basically, the Sharia, that's the only country I'm aware of where the Sharia is the paramount law of the land. And so they basically pressure everybody to do Sharia compliant transactions. And all of their government issuances now, not all, but proportionate amount, more than bond structures, are Sukuk. And they, of course, purchase Sukuk. I'm leaving Malaysia out, but Malaysia is the largest Islamic finance jurisdiction in the world. Both types of financing again. The other area, and probably the predominant area for most of us, are services. The accounting firms are mostly American, law firms, McKinsey and other consulting firms, that sort of thing. We haven't done particularly well with consumer goods and equipment. Caterpillar struggles, for example. It's dominated mostly by Japanese firms and increasingly Korean. It's been a very, very tough area for the United States. Construction activities, Bechtel, people like that, do a great deal of business in the Middle East. It's mostly relational, but for example, Saudi, historically, they're predominant. I noticed in the last couple of years, automobiles, for the first time, U.S. automobiles are starting to be sold, and Kuwait in particular. Bruce pointed out, Jeep's already always done pretty well, but vehicles, other vehicles have not. Truck markets are dominated by Japanese, Toyota in particular. So what's happening right now is the governments would prefer that things be done in a Sharia compliant manner. That's pretty much uniform across the Middle East. European Bank for Reconstruction and Development, EBRD, recently added 5 countries to its jurisdictional ambit, 5 MENA, Middle East and North African countries. So they have a large initiative to increase the amount of Sharia compliant financing and collateral security arrangement. UNCITRAL, same thing. There's new secured transactions law will include Sharia compliant elements. Sukuk, as I say, is the dominant vehicle right now since the economic downturn, and that's spreading into the U.S. and the West generally. This is just an example of a structure to show you, I mean, the Islamic banking and finance sector, there isn't enough money to do a big project financing, even one. The risk concentration would be too high, so bank regulators won't allow it to happen in any event. So you get what are called bifurcated structures like this, single up Islamic tranche. Part of it, the bottom half is a leasing arrangement, that's Sharia compliant. The top half is a conventional loan. This is kind of the dominant form in big ticket infrastructure financing. Okay, Sukuk, I've spoke a little bit about it. There are two types of structures, bond structures, which aren't really bonds, but that's how the press treats them. They're usually whole business securitizations or one big lease cash flows from one large lease. And then there are pools. Pools are where the United States, Canada should excel. We're really good at securitization. And we haven't done much. And there are lots of assets that can be securitized. These are three issuances out of the United States. The first one was an oil and gas property in the Gulf of Mexico. These others, and there'll be some more very, very soon. Just to give you an example of how Malaysia dominates this, just take a look at this chart. You know, they're between 50% and 70%. During the downturn, they were up to 72% of the whole market. Dr. Zeddy, the governor of the Central Bank of Malaysia, is bound and determined to increase the number of assets coming from the United States into Malaysia. Why? For insurance companies, banks are over-concentrated in Malaysian risk. You know, they buy Sukuk that are issued by Malaysian companies. They aren't diversified in their risk profile at all. So you have that happening around the world, Malaysia being the most important place. This is an opportunity in the U.S. So here's a securitization. This is the picture of a conventional loan that I mentioned before. The only difference, if you look up in the top left-hand corner of the bank, well, how do you make that a Sukuk? How do you securitize that? You don't change anything in the structure of the top two left. You put in a trustee, and you sell a bond. The rest of it is a lease. So all of the transactions in the United States, for which there are many billions, are all set up to be securitized. The rent flow, as you'll see here, the arrows, pay the Sukuk, pay the cash flow, pay the debt service on the Sukuk. Two more. What are our opportunities? This is for business in the Middle East. Issuance of Sukuk by North American companies. We're good at securitizations. We can securitize all kinds of assets. And we're starting. Right now we're working on some rail car securitizations, for example. But healthcare facilities all over the US, we probably own 40 into Sharia compliant funds, maybe 40 hospitals and healthcare facilities in the US. Many of those have tax-exempt financing on them, U.S. tax-exempt financing. So we've worked out over the years lots of ways to make this work. Services, we will continue to be a big provider into the Middle East. English law firms are predominant through their former jurisdictions, but that's changing a bit as more and more U.S. assets come in. Big ticket project financings. Consumer goods, there seems to be a glimmer of hope the last couple of years. It's been really bleak, though. We just can't penetrate the market. The perception is, for example, that cars made in the U.S. can't handle the desert conditions. Whether that's true or not, who knows? But that's changing. Chrysler is doing very well. The 300 is doing really, really well in the Middle East. The equipment's just going to take a lot of work. Finally, what opportunities from the Middle East? Real estate financing. Places, if Detroit, for example, could attract more money from the Middle East. There's a huge pool of pent-up funds, investment funds. The investment has been way, way down in the Middle East. People are hoarding their cash in the last 6 years. Real estate is the biggest opportunity. Healthcare. Dubai, for example, is trying to develop. There are no healthcare facilities to speak of, world-class healthcare facilities in the Middle East. Somebody is going to develop a healthcare center. Mayo Clinic has looked at trying to do that. These are huge opportunities for the United States, for hospital systems, because there are none there. Everybody comes to the U.S. Private equity will come up again, and these are the drivers, finally, what did you say? The pool of funds, the need for risk diversification. And look what happened in Dubai with, they're overly concentrated in real estate in Dubai, Middle Eastern investors. They took a terrible beat when that property values dropped in 2008-09. And there's a little more sensitivity to diversifying. Where do they go to diversify? Usually U.S. We're a pretty broadly diversified market. Systemic stability, the dollar, and the number of opportunities. So that's kind of an overview. Thank you very much. Any questions, we can handle specific topics.
Well, thanks very much, Michael. I think Michael has compressed some very complex stuff into a short time. And I think if you're not familiar with Sharia financing, the basic issue is, you know, that in Sharia you can't charge interest. So I remember many years ago writing bank loan agreements for a Saudi Arabian borrower. All I did was I took the word interest, I crossed it out, and I changed it to fee. But those days are gone. And that kind of, that was not Sharia compliant. And certainly, you know, there's a much more sophisticated level of structuring that goes on. And Michael has really given us an overview on that in just a short time. So thanks much. I think we'll switch from the Middle East to China and ask Vivian to just touch on some highlights from the Chinese perspective. She's going to do that in English.
Okay, it's really a great pleasure to be here today. And I think my talk won't be that high level, and I'm trying to share with you some experience that I have assisting my U.S. clients doing business in China. And I will try to focus like one area, that is how compliance issues can affect our deal-making process. Compliance is very general topic, and it can cover from like anti-bribery issues, antitrust, environment compliance issues, and sometimes even employment compliance issues. But for today's topic, I will tend to focus mainly on the anti-bribery issues. I'm sure that some of you may have read the Chinese news reports about the new leadership's emphasis on anti-bribery issues. And you have heard about the very scary stories about the downgrade conducted by the Chinese authorities. And also the record fine recently have been issued by the Chinese courts. So how does this affect our U.S. clients? I think probably you have all heard about the U.S. FCPA. That means if a Chinese subsidiary buys a U.S. company, that means the U.S. parent company can get fined by the because of the wrongdoings of its Chinese subsidiary doing business in China. That's why the FCPA actually has this long arm jurisdiction over the Chinese subsidiaries. And there is kind of a very challenge and complex theory on how they get rich to the Chinese subsidiaries. And I won't, like, just to simplify, I won't touch that for today's presentation purpose. So that's why, because of FCPA, the big fines, and also because Chinese government investigation on bribery issues, that really makes our U.S. clients concerned about their business in China. So how it affect our deal making? I used to be I'm a lawyer, as Bruce has introduced, because I help U.S. clients structure their deals in China. And nowadays, I tend to focus more and more on the compliance side. So thinking about a U.S. client, good luck at all, they want to start their own business in China, because China has a huge market and has a bright future, a very good growth rate. And then they want to, one thing they probably will ask you first is that, do I need a business partner? I probably yes. I want to learn more, learn better about Chinese market, and I need someone to at least handhold me in the first place. Okay, the question is, how to pick up a good business partner? you know, nowadays a lot of the business opportunities here, and sometimes the business partners, you will meet like different persons. They will have very good stories to tell you. From a compliance perspective, it's quite important to find a good business partner. Why? It's just so difficult to change people's mind from compliance perspective. Sometimes, in the old days, like for due diligence, it's just pretty straightforward. We check the business license, tax certificates, review the contracts, and check whether they have like pending litigation, talk to the management generally, learning about the business. Nowadays, because of all these compliance issues, our approach of due diligence has also been changed. We need to actually go into more details to understand about how your business partners doing business in China. And not really focus on the document review. Of course, paper review is an important component, but most important is to, as lawyers, we tend to take a more like a thorough approach when talking to business partners, trying to understand how they're doing business in China. Some business partners, they are not really well trained on compliance matters, so they will tell you, I need to do kickbacks because that's a hidden rule in the industry and everyone does this. I just cannot survive without doing this. Some people, they will just talk about issues and bring on the table, but others, they do not. They have been trained very carefully and they will answer your question in a smart way. They will hide all the issues. But when you talk about, and they were saying that, oh, we are creative, we have different solutions. For example, we don't do kickbacks, but we kind of try to give more money to our people and let them do what they want to do. You know, people sometimes they are trying to, like, boast himself as a good business person and try to work around the rules. And then lawyers, we can play a role and try to identify those like high risks. So it's quite important that we have the skills, like interpersonal skills is also quite important. You don't want to piss off the potential good friends or the wife of your clients. And on the hand, you want to like safeguard all the potential risks for your clients. So that's a very demanding request for the compliance lawyers. Try to follow the compliance rules. On the other hand, try to build up the relationship. That's the due diligence. And second part, okay, you find the good business partner and you are sitting together and then you need to negotiate and then you need to think about deal structure. It's so common that even today, you will identify like, all kinds of different compliance issues when you are doing the deal in China. But that's not the full stop. That's not the end of the day. There are still something that as lawyers we can do to help our clients to reach their goal. For example, if you identify like a certain part of the business is quite risky, and then the business partner, they try to do it like, or maybe the targets, they try to use the kickbacks or other like improper ways to generate business. That's not the end of the world. We still can manage it with a deal structure. For example, we switch from a share deal to an asset deal. Not sure whether you're familiar with this idea. I mean, in a share deal, that means you buy directly the equity interests of the target company. But assets, you got to cherry pick. For example, you're interested in one part of assets, and then you can cut out and buy it. But mainly, I think most of the deals, because the clients are really want to buy the assets, the operational assets, on an ongoing basis. So sometimes it's just quite difficult to carve out the like changing assets. For example, what kind of contracts have been obtained through like improper means. So you need to carefully carve out the assets and try to talk to the salesperson and try to talk to the customers of the targets, try to understand the scenario and then build up the deal structure carefully. And also one thing is quite important and you can help your clients to accurately evaluate the value of assets. Why I say this? Because of the compliance issue can reflect in the value in the evaluation of assets. Why? Thinking about a business model which is heavily driven by the like commercial bribery means, by the kickbacks, by some other requirements like a sightseeing to offer to the clients, then if your client is a U.S. company, then that business model has to be changed after its closing. If the business model has been changed, and it will have impact on your future business, will have impact on your future revenue generation, business operation. So you need to talk to the business partners, understand that, or the target company, to understand that the level, how much they really rely on those lacking requirements. Again, it's a kind of a difficult dialogue because the tension between the parties, sometimes the Chinese parties or the Chinese sellers, targets, they just cannot understand it. They just emphasize that it's whatever, everybody's doing this. So it's kind of really tough when you're trying to step in that role. But I just emphasize that we're actually moving towards to a better and better stage. So while lawyers making efforts and educate the Chinese party's targets, they'll get better to understand it. And sometimes, depending on your bargaining powers, you do have some like a flexibility to renegotiate the purchase price. And after that, you're all happy and happy with the deal structure, or probably switch from the share deal to the asset deal and carve out some tainted assets and try to figure out like who are the problematic salesperson you don't want to deal with, try to build up some like compliance safeguards, and then you're entering an area which is critical, that is post-acquisition integration. People are very familiar about like the merger and acquisition, the deal structure, but in terms of the post-acquisition integration, that means you close the deal, now it's all your responsibility, try to restructure the company. Then the compliance issue can play a very important role, which means you actually start thinking about how you are going to cure all those compliance issues. And the clients turn to us because of different issues. After the closing, they still find like the compliance issues, the kickbacks. They try to tend to the U.S. headquarters to ask for like a global standard best practice. But again, like as a lawyer, like was trained in China and the U.S., we have the advantage to help the clients to build up the bridge, and the most importantly, to help them localize their compliance policy and try to embed into the China context. That could be another challenging job as well, because we're talking about compliance policies, we're talking about ask rules, we're talking about hotline, the setup, and also we are talking about independence of the compliance officers or legal departments. But sometimes it just gets very challenging in China as well, and they need external resources to help them out. For example, after the closing, and we need to deliver compliance training to all the employees, that means, okay, the US company, they married with a Chinese company, and they need to like work together and to figure out which is the best way to do business in China. And then we need to help them to understand as a subsidiary of a US company, the game rule can be changed to a certain extent. Something you get used to probably won't work this time. And we need to prepare. For example, sometimes we do like not only the compliance training to the ordinary people, but some tailor-made trainings to the management, not only top management, but more importantly, to the middle-level management team. For example, like the sales manager, regional sales manager, we need to like present with them like case studies, trying to help them to understand what are the potential risks, what are the potential red flags there. So it's like the Chinese law and bribery rules, not only about Chinese cases. We need to learn more about FCP cases, US cases, FCP enforcement against like companies which has a China component. It's quite important that you are doing the bridging and help people to understand each other. I think that's kind of the most interesting part and also the most challenging part in my practice. Okay, two more minutes. Good. I'm kind of thinking that it would be a good opportunity to invite questions and to generate some discussion on these tough issues. Because I know like anti-bribery actually is an endeavor. It's a global endeavor. We are trying to build up the clean world. And you probably have heard about that. There is a big tension right now between the US government and the Chinese government because they are talking about whether there is like a selective enforcement action against the US companies or the Western companies in China, not only about the anti-bribery enforcement, but more important about antitrust enforcement. That attracted a lot of the like discussion that Chinese government, what they are doing, they are trying to like wait off the foreign investment. I think, let's say like the anti-bribery efforts or antitrust enforcement actions, it took a while for the Chinese government to build up their like procedure rules to improve the due process. But I think the ultimate goal actually is to build up a clean world, a fair like gameplay rules for everyone, including the Chinese companies and also the US companies. Because China right now, the growth model has been changed. In past, it just stick to like the investment-driven model. We invite foreign investment, we invite, and we do not really care that much about like the, really the compliance issue, like environmental issue, and trust is much less concern. But nowadays, as we are getting to a stage, we are trying to like make our development model more healthy, and we put more emphasis in that part. I think it takes time to really to build up the resources and to try to like have the due process as in what we have in US. But I'm still quite optimistic about the bright future. And being part of the development makes me feel even more proud.
Thanks very much, Vivian. We're going to have more questions for you, though, so just be ready. Okay, we're going to turn to India now, and Gurinder Singh is going to give us a few highlights to think about there, and I hope you're all like keeping track of the questions that you want to ask our panelists. So, India.
All right, good morning, everybody. I'm very pleased to be here, especially since, as was mentioned, I am a law alum, so I'm very happy to be here. And I'd like to thank Professor Fox and Rachel and the other staff and faculty here at the International Legal Studies Program for the opportunity to be here, and also commend Professor Fox for leading the International Legal Program, which has become one of the best in the country. So we really want to thank you for that, and also just express how honored I am to be here. What I'm going to do is discuss the cross-border, the legal issues that arise in cross-border transactions in the US and India. However, I have experienced both in doing deals outbound out of India into the United States and also inside inbound into India from the United States. But because there are more unique issues into India, that's what I'm going to be focusing on today. And what I'm going to do is start with a political and economic overview of India and India's climate today. And then I'll go on and provide a little overview of India's foreign direct investment policy, and then give you a little overview on the different types of structures that you can do in order to how to structure your transactions into India. And then I'll go through and provide a little overview summary of the new Companies Act that was just enacted and put into force this month. And then I'll give some more summaries on some of the other legal issues that you'll come across when you start doing business into India. So India at a glance, As you all, most of you know, India is the largest democracy in the world, and it is the second most populous country in the world as well, with 1.3 billion people. And the country, it has 29 states. Actually, the most recent state just came into being earlier in the year, this year. And there are 22 official languages in India and many more dialects and various major religions and hundreds of local regional political parties. So that just gives you a sense of how diverse India is. And unfortunately, if you've been following the news, you know that the last few years, the Indian economy had not been doing too well. And a lot of it was because of the government's inability to make a decision or to keep with a decision. I know that at one point, the Indian government had enacted reforms to the retail industry, and then a week later, they just said, oh, no, sorry, we were just kidding. So that really created a lot of frustration in the business community. And as you'll, I'll show you a few graphs now of what impact it, that, and along with high inflation rates, rupee was, the value of the rupee went down drastically, the capital account deficit is very high right now, and generally speaking, the stagnation of the country, the government, is what really halted the GDP growth. As you'll see, just recently, it's been declining, and now economists are projecting that it'll increase, and I'll explain to you why. And the reason why I think it's important for you to know why is because a lot of these reasons are, a lot of what's going on right now in the country will really dictate where, what happens in the near future with respect to reforms and all the different laws that, that the country is thinking about enacting and reforming and amending. So that's the GDP. Inflation and deficits, they're both subsiding in the past few months, but they're still pretty high. And so, really, the reason why these changes are happening is because, as many of you probably know, India had a change in its government earlier this year in May 2014 during the general elections. The BJP, Bharatiya Janata Party, actually won. And this is a landslide victory. It was the first time in 30 years that one party actually had the majority on its own to control the house. And so what happens in India is like the Lok Sabha, then they elect the prime minister, Narendra Modi was elected. And a lot of the business community is really behind Narendra Modi because he, if you don't know, he was also the the chief minister of Gujarat, the state of Gujarat, which has become now the number one destination for investments into India. And so a lot of the business community really wanted to support him and to take office. Unfortunately, he did have some people who were opposed to him, and a lot of it goes back to the riots in Gujarat in 2002, where there were 1,000 to 2,000 people who were killed under his watch. And so some people thought that he could have done a little bit more to lessen the amount of people that got killed and just really help that situation. And so now he's taken office, and initially people were very excited that he was taking office, but the budget, new budget, which comes out, this time it came out in August, it was earlier in the year, I believe it was like June, sometime in the summer, where it came out. And the budget really wasn't very optimistic. There weren't many reforms that the government said they were going to do, although that's what Narendra Modi ran on. So, but there, this last week, or maybe a week and a half ago, there are two states that had their elections and the BJP won again. So there's some sign that there are going to be some reforms. What type of reforms? There's talks about labor reforms, which is probably the most difficult aspect of doing a deal in India. One of the most difficult aspects of doing a deal in India. And so some other reforms, which I'll touch on later. But I'll go into right now, just give you a little overview of the FDI policy in India. Foreign direct investment is permitted in India in certain sectors. So the first thing that you need to think about when you're looking at going into India India or your clients want to go into India is whether India allows foreign direct investment in that particular industry or sector. And then the next question is, okay, well, or are there any restrictions? And if there are, how do you structure the transaction? And do you need a partner and things like that? There are many automatic routes. So actually, that most of the industries are permitted where people, companies, foreign companies can invest up to 100%. And like the automotive industry, for example, and just general industries, there are certain industries that are restricted to certain caps where there's not, you can't invest 100%, but you can invest up to 50% or 49% or 26%. So those types of industries include like the retail sector, for example, which there are some easings in the single brand retail sector, but the defense is another industry, and insurance is another industry where there are prohibitions, restrictions. And then there are certain industries that are just prohibited for foreign direct investment. So when you know that you want to go into India, then the next question or the next issue that you need to consider is, okay, well, what structure do I want to use in order to go into India? And there are many different ways. The first way that many companies use in order to just have a foothold in India is a liaison office. And that's the advantage to the liaison office is that if you can qualify to be a liaison office in India, you don't have to pay tax in India. But you can only perform certain types of activities. This is like if you have a sales rep office, you just promoting your company, your parent company, you're promoting your services, but you're not really conducting any business. And so so there are certain restrictions. But even after those restrictions are a minimum, there's a minimum that you need to show from your parent company in terms of the amount of revenue and your track record of business profitability. Your company has to be worth at least $50,000 in order to be able to apply for a liaison office in India. And you also have to show a track record of profits for three years before you can open a liaison office. And then you apply to the Reserve Bank of India and ask them for an application or a license, I'm sorry. And the license is usually granted for 3 years, which has to be renewed. The next type of structure is a project office. And a project office is similar to a liaison office, but you can do more things. So with a project, project and branch offices are very similar. Project office is a type of a branch office. We'll talk about branch offices first. A branch office allows you to do a little bit more than a liaison office. And a branch office, allows you to do a little bit more than a liaison office. You can sell products, export and import products. With one exception, actually, you can manufacture products if you're in a special economic zone. And so if you want to go into India, but you don't want to make a full commitment of becoming an actual company, Indian company, then it's subject to the Companies Act, then what you should think about doing is maybe opening up a branch office, and if you can find a special economic zone in order to open that in, then that's even better. And then the project office, as I mentioned, is similar to the branch office, except that that's per project. So you have to show, you have a certain project that you got, say, from a customer or the government, and then with that project, you can actually open up a project office. Similar concept with the liaison office where you apply to the Reserve Bank of India, they give you the approval if you qualify, and then you get your license good for 3 years and that you can renew. And then the most popular way is a wholly owned subsidiary. You actually form a company in India. You become an Indian company subject to the Indian Companies Act. And there are several other ways you can do business in India, with India. Joint ventures and strategic alliances are very popular option. You can either set up a joint venture company, and then there are certain restrictions, certain things that you should think about when you're doing a joint venture company. But an agreement is also another way to go into India. And the benefit for agreements, similarly to the distributorship and the purchase sale agreements, which are all just contracts, basic contracts, is that you have contract law which applies. And so you can have U.S. law apply to those agreements, and then so your activities are actually governed by U.S. law and what you're negotiating, except for, you know, what you can't contract because of public policy reasons and whatnot. And one thing you should, another topic on its own, permanent establishment, it's really important that you structure your transactions into India properly to minimize the unintended tax consequences. And so sometimes your parent company can actually be responsible for tax because of your subsidiaries' activities in India. So that's just something to think about. So I'll just give you a few highlights of the New Companies Act. Again, this is very brand new. It replaces the old Companies Act of 1956, and there are several concepts that are added now. You can have a one-person company with only one director before you needed two directors for every company. But there are certain other restrictions that you need to abide by. For example, every company has to have a director who stayed in India the previous calendar year for a total of 182 days. So that's something you should keep in mind. And this is only for the public companies, but all public companies must have at least one woman director, which is very interesting. In corporate governance is just a trend throughout the New Companies Act where they're trying to improve the corporate governance. And then so there are certain other updates, and I can send some of these to you if you'd like after it. Just some other things I want to touch on because I don't have limited time is just things you should think about when you're entering into those agreement type of arrangements, so joint ventures, strategic alliances. There are a few things to think about. One, if you're entering into an agreement to export some goods into India, then you should know that the Sale of Goods Act will apply, and then also the general principles of contract law. And all contracts are generally covered by the Contract Act. And contract law in India is very similar to contract law in the United States. There aren't too many deviations. Although there's one thing I do want to point out towards the end that India doesn't recognize trade secrets, so that's just something to think about because India finds that to be a prohibition or a restriction of trade, or restraint on trade. So they don't really, they don't recognize trade secrets. So you have to really think about how to structure your agreement. Another thing I want to point out is, again, the governing law. Whenever you're entering into an agreement with an Indian party, I recommend try to have governing law apply. Typically, Indian companies will agree to New York law, and if they don't agree to U.S. law, then maybe even finding another jurisdiction. And then you want to stay out of Indian courts, and actually most Indian companies also want to stay out of Indian courts. So I would say, your dispute resolution provision is very important to make sure that you really draft that very carefully. We recommend arbitration, and usually arbitration in Singapore is the way to go. Indians like Singapore. They also like Hong Kong, but for U.S. and I think Singapore is better. They have a fast track system as well, where you can get some of your arbitrations heard and cleared very quickly. And I won't mention some of the other, some documents you have to get them stamped, and there's just so many different issues when you're dealing with just the nuances. Other critical issues, corruption is a big issue in India too, just like China. Foreign Corrupt Practices Act, I won't get into the details of it, but corruption is a big issue. The government is trying to hammer down and trying to actually, enact some more anti-corruption laws and actually enforce them. And I think they're making some headway, but it's going to take some time. It's definitely going to take some time. Land acquisition is a big problem in India because there's no central title system like we have here in the United States. You can't actually go and see who owns this land. So that becomes, for almost all the deals, that's in India, if there's land involved, that's a huge issue. So that's why Gujarat has been very successful in attracting business, because in Gujarat, draft, they just gave out, you know, this is the land and you have the title to it. So they started getting getting involved in making sure that the land had their title. Because you have people coming up saying, you know, I own this land or my grandfather owned this land, and it happens all the time. It's a huge issue in India. Again, I mentioned the stringent labor laws. It's almost impossible to let go of people in India. And so that's why people are very, you know, hesitant about hiring people. There are certain laws, labor laws, that apply if you have 10 or 20. All right, I don't have any more time. So I'll distribute this. There's just, yeah, a lot of different issues when you're doing business with India. So I guess we can keep, you know, if there are any questions at the end.
Thanks, Grander. I know that on any of one of these speakers we could spend the whole day, but there's a question for you that I want to get to, and that's why I wanted to make sure that I had a chance to get that in. You know, in structuring transactions, we would often, as transactional lawyers, look to not have the main operating company of our client make the acquisition directly. There might be concerns about taxation, exposure to litigation in the other country, various reasons, but so we might have subsidiaries and tax structures and various things. There might be multiple tiers of subsidiaries that would ultimately own the company in India. Now, big company Vodafone made an acquisition in India. It was actually a couple years ago, or actually 2007, for $11.1 billion. They bought it. They bought the Cayman Islands country, as I recall, which with various tiers through Mauritius, which is a tax haven country that has an attractive treaty with India, actually ultimately owned Indian companies. Well, the Indian tax authority said, well, this is great. We're gonna charge you a withholding tax on this transaction. Now, had it been an actual direct purchase of an Indian company for $11.1 billion, they would have imposed a $2.5 billion withholding tax. Well, this was all indirect. And they said, well, it doesn't matter, you know, it's $2.5 billion. Well, they took the case to the Indian Supreme Court, and notably, although you may comment about the Indian courts, but I think in this case, the Indian Supreme Court rejected the tax authorities and said that they really did not have jurisdiction to tax this indirect acquisition where the shares that were transferred were actually shares of a company outside India. And I think the tax authorities have been wanting to get back in there somehow. Is there any movement on that? Or where are we if we're trying to make an indirect acquisition in India?
The tax authorities are trying to get back in there. And there was something that recently that was that the tax authorities put up, which actually said, no, they have the authority to tax capital gains. It's like it's kind of like that scenario, really, the Mauritius, Cayman Islands scenario, the Vodafone case. Then they said, oh, and you know, and we can do it retroactively, which that caused another storm. And then so that the government voted came in and they said, no, well, we're still going to recognize that some of these taxes can be imposed, but we're not going to impose anything retroactively. And the business community is, for them, it's like, it's just certainty. They just want to know exactly, okay, if I'm going to be taxed, fine. If that's fine to me, so that I can structure my transaction however it needs to be. But there's the stuff talk about, you know, still tax reform. And Mauritius is no longer, you know, it was the most popular route into India, and now Singapore that could be.
Okay. All right. So the tax authorities in India haven't given up, and I guess they're still trying to find a way. Well, what was interesting about that case was that folks in China saw that and thought, well, this is pretty interesting. And Vivian, I know that you were formerly an M&A lawyer, so I'm going to ask you this question. I recall that China imposed a 10% withholding tax on capital gains from business, you know, this similar kind of a tiered transaction. What's the status of that? Is that actually being effective, or how's that working?
I think we are still trying to attach to those like offshore transactions that structured just for the tax avoidance purpose.
Okay. And that's exactly why we do it. But I mean, you know, the typical structure would be to acquire the Chinese shares through a separate, empty subsidiary. And then for effecting corporate reorganizations or transfers of the interest in that Chinese company to avoid all the procedures that you would have to follow for a share transfer in China and other things, taxes and so on. You transfer just those upper tier shares.
Yeah. I need to clarify because I'm not really a tax lawyer, but based on my limited knowledge about this tax issue, for example, if you set up Hong Kong like a holding company, it's a shell company without any management team, without operation there, and you are trying to sell through the Hong Kong holdco of the shares of a Chinese subsidiary, you would definitely be required to do the tax filing in China, and the tax authority will definitely try to get the tax revenue. The onshore parties would need to disclose that to the tax authority.
So the way the Chinese government would know about it is they require that the Chinese parties disclose
it. Famous 789, like the tax rule.
Okay. Well, let's shift to the Middle East. We mentioned, and Michael has laid out these structures that are pretty complex for us, I mean, in the U.S., all kind of derived toward the Islamic prohibition on interest. And do you want to just give us, maybe it might be helpful just for us to have a little bit of background on that, what it is that makes a transaction Sharia compliant? I mean, I know there's things that are very unusual for us in the West. And then how do you get into governing law? Is it Sharia law or what is it?
As you can imagine, over 30% of the world is Muslim. So it's a big segment of the world. Therefore, the Sharia is many different things. But basically, the word Sharia means the way. It's a guide to how a Muslim leads his or her life. And a very small portion of it deals with law. There's a lot that deals with ritual and ethics and morality and governance and different topics. What we're looking at here is law, which is a relatively small part. There are four sources. Two of them are revealed, the Quran and the Sunnah, which is the behavior and the sayings of the Prophet Muhammad. And then there are two other sources, consensus of the community, which really means consensus of Sharia scholars, and reasoning processes. Those are the main sources. So the Sharia can be very different things. In commerce and finance and in the modern world, what it is in reality is determined by a Sharia board, a group of scholars that come from basically four different schools in Sunni Islam, in the variety. And those are kind of geographically distributed. So North Africa is Maliki, Saudi Arabia is Hanbali, Shafi is the Gulf and Southeast Asia. So it's different things. So when you structure your transaction, you need the approval of a Sharia board as a matter of imprimatur. They'll issue a fatwa. Fatwa is an opinion that's not admissible in court except as an evidentiary matter, but it's not governing law. So what do we do about governing law? Governing law is usually English law or New York law. Contract is structured to be Sharia compliant. Like that, what you saw there is if you give it to a finance lawyer, they will say, well, that's just a leverage lease. They look at that, which of course is the dominant structural mechanism for financing in the world. And that's very intentional. When we develop these structures, we model them on leverage leases. We can use them in the US. You know what the courts are going to do with bankruptcy issues, security issues of all kinds, and in Sharia compliant. So we generally pick New York law or English law. There is usually no mention of the Sharia in any of the documents. Sometimes there is. I mean, sometimes, particularly young people coming out of the madrasa environment will want to mention Sharia. But there are appellate court cases, particularly in England, that made it very clear that the Sharia is not a national body of law under the Rome Convention and can't be used to enforce the agreements. So that's the general.
So, I mean, in a U.S. or Western transaction or Chinese transaction of financing, we have a financing agreement, we have a legal opinion from lawyers that under this governing law, this is an enforceable agreement. So I gather we have the same thing under New York or London law, but we would also have a Sharia scholar's opinion, would we?
Yes.
Saying, in addition, that this is compliant with Sharia.
Yeah. So you rely on the scholars to say it's Sharia compliant. You rely on the New York law or English law to enforce the agreement.
Okay, great. I want to ask you one other thing, Michael, about the anti-boycott laws that we have in the United States. And this is not really widely known, but it's an issue that that comes up. But the Arab states in the Arab League have had a policy of actually not dealing with Israel. So, you know, you won't fly from Tel Aviv to Dubai. You'll have to maybe go through Jordan or something, or another country. And it also extends to transactions involving Israel. So I had a client once that engaged in, they were making a sale into a Middle Eastern country. They had a letter of credit under which they were going to be paid. One of the documents that they had to present under the letter of credit was a document that certified that the goods being sold were not of Israeli origin. Now, what this actually is a violation of the U.S. Anti-boycott laws, which prohibit any action in furtherance of the Arab boycott of Israel. So the client was not aware of this until they got a charging letter from the U.S. Justice Department accusing them of violating the laws governing the boycott. How did this come to light? Well, the banking regulators in the U.S. go in and do bank examinations, and this is one of the things on the list. And they go through letters of credit. They look for letters of credit that might have boycott furtherance provisions in them, and then they get the bank and they get the parties to the transaction. So, but it also goes to other things. Johns Hopkins University wanted to expand. Mike was talking about healthcare being an opportunity. Johns Hopkins wanted to expand their marketing to wealthy Arab League people to bring them to Johns Hopkins for treatment. And there was a Jewish person who applied for that job as the marketing director and was denied. Well, the U.S. government learned of this somehow, and Johns Hopkins wound up having to admit that they had taken an action in furtherance of the Arab boycott of Israel by refusing, discriminating against this Jewish person who they believed would not be the best person to pursue opportunities for them in the Arab markets. It even affects lawyers. There was a case where a Massachusetts lawyer wanted to file a trademark in Saudi Arabia. He was given a form that required a certification that the trademark had no relationship with Israel. He went to the State Department to get the certification that was called for. He used a Virginia lawyer to get that form. The Virginia lawyer sent the form back, said the State Department rejected it because it violates U.S. anti-boycott law. So the lawyer from Massachusetts went to an Arab League agency, and he obtained a certification there. He sent that in. It was the U.S. Arab Chamber of Commerce. Sent that into Saudi Arabia. They said, well, that doesn't work. We need it from the State Department. But we've eliminated that requirement since you first got involved in this, because we knew the State Department would reject it. Well, somehow the U.S. officials learned of this, and he was prosecuted for a violation of furthering the Arab boycott against Israel, and wound up, he had no defense really, because the Virginia lawyer told him that the State Department rejected his application based on that violation. But I know that, I mean, this, so it's an issue that can affect a lot of people, It's not really widely understood, but what's the status right now, Michael? Are the Arab countries enforcing it? In this case with the lawyer, Saudi Arabia had changed their form because they knew the State Department would reject it. But is it something that we need to...
Well, it's clearly something we should pay attention to. Really need to pay attention to. I haven't seen an instance of it in the last at least 7-8 years, personally. We do a lot of, which despite the rhetoric, you know, one of the things about the Middle East, and I think generally, there's a great deal of rhetoric that's ignored in practice. It doesn't constitute the practice. So we do joint Israeli Middle Eastern investments, power plants, and things like that, which clearly contrary to expressed policy of the Arab League. But it happens all the time. I haven't seen it on a form. I've been questioned about it a lot because, for example, my team within my law firm is interestingly enough, is about a little over a third Jewish. We go to the Middle East to do Islamic finance transactions, and we've never had a visa problem or been questioned. But is it the express policy? Clearly it is.
It's stated policy, but not really enforced or by the Arab countries.
But your observation last night, and you can inform me on this, there are times when sensitivities increase, and then the rhetoric comes out, and then you might get the example.
Professor Dolan, here.
What you do when you get those documents, you don't say it's not of Israeli origin, you say it is of U.S. origin. That doesn't violate the statute.
Right, and that's the easy solution to the issue, but the problem is that clients don't know that the issue was even there until they get the charging letter from the Justice Department. So, well, China, Vivian, on compliance, I want to ask you a couple of questions. Just sometimes there's a concern, too, about liability flowing up to the shareholder entities, you know, in other countries. I mean, is that an issue with respect to some of these violations of a Chinese entity owned by, say, an American company? Could directors and officers of the American company be held liable for violations?
I would say it's more like the U.S. FCP issue as opposed to a PRC bribery issue.
Yeah.
Because we need to look into the facts to identify whether the U.S. FCP has a jurisdiction like the original SEC has a jurisdiction over the particular case. But in my opinion, personal opinion, I think that the U.S. FCP enforcement agencies, they are very aggressively establishing the jurisdiction upon the subsidiaries of the U.S. companies. That's a general trend. So that's why, our U.S. clients, once they have operation in China, whether it's through the distribution or even a joint venture or wholly owned subsidiary, they will have some exposure under the FCP to a certain extent. On the politicized FCP, in terms of the Chinese bribery law, I think the Chinese bribery law is still attached as a separate legal entity. But under PRC law, we have those concepts unit crime or individual crime. So there are some different concepts.
Okay, so under the FCPA, if you're a public company or have securities registered with the SEC, you can also not just be in violation of the bribery provisions if a bribe happens, but also for not keeping records. So if you have two sets of books and you don't record that that bribe that's paid in your records, that's a separate violation that the SEC can follow. Now, my question sort of to you as a former M&A lawyer, Chinese company might have two or three sets of books. I mean, one for the bank, one for the tax people, one for the shareholders. I mean, how do you deal with this issue?
Well, that's really, because if the U.S. parent company is a listed company, then the internal control provision will apply. Internal control means that you need to have a financial control, accurate books and records, etc. But the problem that for the China especially China's series, they will have all this like two groups issue. And sometimes depending on how serious, because in most cases, like the internal control issue and bribery issue, they are interrelated. So if they also have some like bribery problems, like red flags, they probably need to, if it's serious enough, they need to consider whether to do the voluntary disclosure under the US law. In terms of voluntary disclosure in China, that's something different, and we need to discuss it under the Chinese law context.
So just from a straight due diligence standpoint, then when you're making an acquisition in China, you ask, give us all of your sets of books and what did
In the M&A context, it's a little bit different because it's like, for example, you are acquiring a Chinese company and that local company prior to the acquisition, it is not subject to the US FCPA. So you still have a chance to cure it post the acquisition. So that means that after the acquisition, the target company, after integrated into the US company group, then you have issued only have one book.
Well, let's see it. I asked all of you to make some notes of questions that you might have. Do we have any questions here? We have a mic. Professor Fox has a mic.
Hi, I'm Jade. I'm a third-year law student from Beijing, China. I actually have a question for Mr. McMillan. Yeah. What do you think from the investment prospect makes Sukuk a better choice than a similar bond that have the same profit and risk profile? Thank you.
Well, I'm not sure it is better or worse. I can't really comment on any particular issuance. They're structured usually, if you compare them to a bond, who's the obligor on the bond? Is it corporate credit or something? They're structured as securitizations. So to the extent that you identify some cash flows, people have preferences for that. Often you lock up, let's say you use a ship and processing platform in the Gulf of Mexico, which is a huge ship that converts oil out of the ground into something that can be put through a pipeline to the land. You're dedicating all of the cash flows from that operation, plus usually a corporate credit. Some people prefer that. A lot of the securitizations themselves are just government credits. Who's the lessee, the ultimate lessee in that structure? So what are you buying? You're buying a government credit. Is that any different than bond structure? That's your analysis. So I can't say one's better than the other. People are buying credits. Why do pension funds buy these things? They're government credits. They're Middle Eastern government credits or Southeast Asian government credits.
But I guess the key is that it's gonna, to have a real compliant financing or transaction is gonna open up access to a lot of capital that you wouldn't otherwise have. So. An American might buy the straight transaction, but an Arab, investment fund may be restricted only to Sharia compliant.
Yeah, usually they aren't restricted, but there's a preference. What it does do for you is take out some asset classes, and so you're gonna remove derivatives from the picture because. There's a fundamental principle of the Sharia that somewhere you have to have a tangible asset. There are very few exceptions to that. Intellectual property is one. But on the whole, you have to have a tangible asset. So you remove a number of tiered transactions, financial transactions like derivatives. There's a preference for that. Some people have a preference for ethical investing generally. They don't want alcohol involvements. Here I'm talking about human consumption for mood alteration purposes. But other alcohols, even under the Sharia, are just fine. If you're using it for healthcare, cleaning industrial. industrial parts, you know, there's, people are misled about the extent of some of these requirements. That sort of alcohol use is fine. But some institutions prefer to remove those topics, and there's the group as an advantage because they must do it.
Okay, other questions, Howard?
To the lady from Indian, I apologize. I don't remember.
We have a microphone for you here.
Oh, okay. The lady from India, there was a
period. You're up.
There was a period of time in which there was more outsourcing to India in terms of services like call centers, and in fact there was a movement to have document reviews for legal purposes done in India and sent over. Recently, I've gotten the impression that one large American law firms have felt threatened, so they set up their own contract lawyers reviewing cheaper than their associates. But that for other reasons, that some of these call centers are being closed and brought back. What is the state of that, and especially the legal outsourcing in India?
Well, yeah, for the legal outsourcing, I know it's doing really well in India, although I know I've seen some documents or documents that quality isn't really there. In fact, I think a lot of it is because legal, like especially contract review type work, that's very recent. Even within India, like lawyers conducting that type of work is pretty recent. And so, I mean, I've seen a lot of companies use it. I know a lot of like even Fortune 100 companies have their own companies that are set up in India for that purpose, for legal outsourcing or document review or due diligence, discovery type of thing, things like that. So I've just seen it thriving. I know that other call centers, like you know, telephone, like those types of call centers, I've seen them actually going to like the Philippines these days, not necessarily coming back to the United States. What I have seen coming back to the United States is like engineering design work. A lot of that is coming back to the United States. I think a lot of that is because of the know-how here, especially in Michigan. There's more of that coming back that I've seen.
Make one observation too. I've had some clients make this response that some of the work coming back from India to the extent that it involved legal analysis, they got back English law. And it was very noticeable.
Yeah.
It was, you know, they were very displeased with that aspect. Now, that may be quite rare, I don't know, but.
No, I think that's actually pretty common, especially with analysis.
Okay. Other comments, questions? Professor Bill? I think we're supposed to use the mics. Professor Fox is taping us.
He's a professor, he can be heard.
This is for Mr. Mullen. Have you had any dealings with the Office of Foreign Asset Compliance in getting opportunities, licenses to go and get around the restriction on trading in some of the countries and corporations?
I have not personally. There are people in the firm who have done that work, and we've been pretty successful. But I personally have not done any of it. I do mostly financing.
Well, what's the key to get the license?
I don't know, but I'll find out for you. I'll work on that, and, you know, the topic. But it's not common. I mean, we are terribly common to have restrictions. It's going into the Middle East has been a little bit difficult. Why? Because usually they're monopolies. I mean, it's kind of my short version of the history of Saudi Arabia. When Abdulaziz formed the country, he had conquered all these regions and he knew nothing about government, so obviously he didn't have foreign government. He gave each tribe a ministry, and when he ran out of ministries, he gave you a monopoly. You got, you know, GM, or you got Mercedes, or whatever. That's really how it worked. The difficulty is dealing with the monopolies. The biggest problem in going in. Because if you go into the UAE, United Arab Emirates, there is one person to deal with. Commercial family that's quite favored.
questions?
My name is May. I have a question for Vivian Wu. I apologize first that I don't have any legal background, so my question seems naive. But I understand that you are working to help American parent company to establish a relationship with the subsidy of the China company. You mentioned about that you need to educate both sides to meet the compliance regulation. But there are some other companies. So I have several questions. The first question is, do you need to be fully trained about the US corporate law? And secondly, there are some Chinese attorneys that need to come to the United States if they are interested in the Chinese parent company who want to establish a relationship or to establish investment in the United States, and they also need a Chinese attorney. So what are the different challenges of these two kind of Chinese attorney?
Well, that's a very good question for our Chinese law students and also building up the China legal profession. Asking the first question is that when we help with, for example, U.S. or Western clients doing business in China, we would expect that the attorney at least have some basic understanding about the general principles, for example, the U.S. FCPA law. We don't expect that you would be an expert of that, but at least there are some basic rules, for example, the bribery provision, the accounting, or the internal control provision. You need to have some basic understanding. And for take myself as an example. I work closely with our US FCPA experts on those really tough technical issues. And we exchange with each other on the latest development on the FCPA issues. I mean, being part of the, a member of the global international law firm, that's actually our strength because we can work with colleagues in different jurisdictions. So I'm still thinking that part, the legal background in China is quite important. It's an essential part. But if you have US training background, that would definitely be a plus. And the second question, I'm very glad that you bring it up. Because nowadays, Chinese companies are following the going broad strategy. We have a lot of the outbound deals, means Chinese companies actually going to US and make investment. Not only in US, but all of the world. In that case, I think that the transaction lawyer need to understand the transaction rules under the common law background. It would be good that if you have very good contract drafting skills, because it's really the global transaction, and in most cases, it won't be governed by the Chinese law. So you need to be careful about the drafting skills. And on the compliance side, because FCPA, I need to explain a little bit, it mainly deals with US companies or US listed companies doing business, bribing foreign officials, Chinese officials in China. So in that sense, the FCPA does not apply to Chinese companies doing business in US. But US has other provisions, other laws and rules addressing that compliance bribery issues in US. That means you need, for example, if you are in-house counsel of a very large state-owned enterprise doing business in US, you need to learn not only the corporate law, but also maybe some general understanding about the other rules, the environmental protection, employment protection, even sexual harassment, and also antitrust, in addition to the anti-bribery issues. So I would expect that we will definitely work with outside counsels if you are in-house lawyer for the large SOEs in China. But a general understanding on that for legal issues would definitely help.
I didn't mention it when I introduced Vivian, but she has two masters in law. Is besides for China law studies. So one from the University of Paris Sorbonne, and another one from Harvard University. So, so she's and I would say just from my own perspective, when I'm looking to find a lawyer in China or other places, I mean I do like to find those people who have studied law in the United States or maybe in another common law country like England, Canada, Australia, because you know there's a civil law system. In most other countries, we have a common law system, and it's good to have someone who has an understanding of both to kind of merge those. And especially for a lawyer like Vivian now, you know, has experience working here in the United States and developed a good sense of, you know, kind of how American lawyers think and how American clients think. So so that's all very important as well. So she has a great background for what she's doing. And Professor Fox.
I realize we're going over time, but this is a very interesting discussion. I wonder if I could put a version of that same question to Gurinder and Michael, since we have a number of law students here. For American law students who are interested in getting involved in transactions between the United States and India, or the United States and the Middle East, either inbound or outbound, what are the opportunities? Can American law students or American lawyers work in the countries, either for local law firms or offices of American firms there, or are they pretty much restricted to working out of U.S. offices and representing American clients that are going abroad or waiting for foreign companies to come to the United States? Just to give a lay of the land, people may not be familiar with, you know, the scope of the practice and the regions you work in.
Okay, I guess I can start with India. The Indian laws are very restrictive when it comes to foreign lawyers practicing in India, and that's even if you're, say, if you're a U.S. attorney that wants to just practice U.S. law in India. And recently they've changed those rules a little bit, where they allow you to do like the fly-in, fly-out, so you can fly into the country, meet your clients, and then you can advise them. Maybe if you're working on something, you can advise them on that. But you're not staying there, and you can go back to your home country. And before, what was happening was a lot of foreign law firms were sending attorneys and setting up offices in hotel rooms. Actually, even before that, I know Mike, he helped one of the premier law firms, the law firms that had their first office in India, helped open their office. But a lot of those things have changed. So if you're coming out of law school and if you want to practice this type of law, I mean, it would be nice to go into a firm that does that type of work. They maybe have offices in other countries. Again, you won't find that with respect to India, just because foreign law firms can have offices in India. But most Indian firms, U.S. firms, many Michigan law firms have India teams, India groups, and sometimes that's an opportunity for you to be involved. You may not necessarily just be able to do that type of work, so you could take on, just try to go into corporate or M&A, generally speaking, and then you can build your own niche eventually as well. I think there are a lot more opportunities now because the world is becoming global. There are more global deals, and if you have a knack in doing deals internationally, I think it helps. I just started my own firm, and I'm sure hopefully soon I'll also be looking for people to help me to do cross-border transactions, so that would be one opportunity.
If you want to work in the Middle East or Islamic generally, it's pretty easy to accomplish. There are very few countries other than places like Malaysia that would prohibit you as a legal or regulatory matter. So you can work with an English firm, a local firm, a lot of different U.S. firms, a lot of different firms. The harder part is, because I teach Islamic finance at the University of Pennsylvania Law School and Wharton School, people ask all the time, can I have a job? And the answer is yes, but first I want you to become a finance lawyer and to go away and spend 3 years becoming a finance lawyer, and then you can do Islamic finance. Because most of the world is dominated by interest-based systems, and you're doing accommodation. And the principles of finance finance, you know, it's not terribly helpful to me. That's the bigger problem. It's how do you train someone? I have an arrangement with one of the most famous, probably the most famous Sharia scholar in the world, who runs a madrasa in Karachi. And what he wants to do is take a number of his students each year, who are very, very devout kids, and are, you know, appalled by the concept of interest. Ship them to me, and I put them on only interest-based transactions for 2 or 3 years, and send them back. So I'm not alone in this assessment. I mean, and this is a scholar who shares that abhorrence of the concept of interest. But you need to train people in a financial system and to know what the world's about financially. Can I make one other comment? You know, I'm puzzled by the OFAC. I don't think any of the countries, I haven't dealt with any countries on a financing matter that are on the list. I'm sitting here thinking Iran has Iranian assets. Control program is not involved in Islamic finance. And I don't know.
People were selling into Iran under the food program.
Yeah.
And, but in Iraq, they're covered by sanctions, are they not?
Yeah, some. But I don't run into them in deals. And part of it is either people that I'm dealing with don't want to go there, or they don't have any money to come here.
Well, we're a manufacturing economy in Michigan, and the manufacturers, yeah, of course, they do. They want to sell them into Syria.
Yeah. Oh, and I do some work in Syria. I mean, through some arrangements up until recently, the last year and a half. But I was puzzled. I'm puzzled by it because of why isn't it I'm not seeing any of that? I will talk to my partners and get back to you on it. But on the finance side, I just never see it. Anyway.
Thank you, Professor Fox. We're over time, but I know we do have another question. I see back here. But one, do you want more?
Yes, that's fine.
Okay. We're way in the back. We just need a microphone.
GSA, General Services Administration, actually sent me an email and fell. We're going to do another Sharia compliant deal with them. So, yeah, we've done maybe 20 GSA transactions. We've done, the government's very supportive, actually. The United States is a very easy trust. New York State, on that lease structure last year, 2 years ago, issued a tax ruling. Saying that for U.S. tax purposes, that's a loan, not a lease structure, which is an extraordinarily helpful development. The Office of the Comptroller of the Currency has given two rulings, and in both of them, they were very supportive of the Islamic finance structures. They took away all the bank regulatory problems. So it's a very easy place. We don't have Islamic banks. It's a difficult place to get any bank. But there's been the Federal Reserve Bank in New York has a whole committee on Islamic banking and Islamic finance. Pretty well informed. Going back to your first question, interest is far from the only one. This is a 1,400-year-old legal system. There are lots of things. So there are, for example, prohibited business activities, alcohol, pork, interest-based finance of any type. There are five categories of activities under the Sharia. There are two categories, one where it's expressly prohibited and one where it might, it's not, it's discouraged. in those areas. So are weapons, some scholars say you can't deal with weapons at all. Other scholars say, no scholar lets you deal with weapons of mass destruction. But the others debate, what about tobacco? You know, things like that. You go through, there are lots of unclear areas. Last year I wrote a book on one fatwa, which was rendered to Dow Jones, which addresses your kinds of issues. Here, in 1998, prior to 1998, if you tried to buy a share of stock, you were a devout Muslim and you tried to buy a share of stock, basically there was no stock in the world you could buy. Because every company has, pays or receives interest or is engaged in some activity. Dow Jones spent from 93 to 99 trying to get this one fatwa. And it deals with equity investing, which goes to your question. When can you buy a share of stock, or when can you invest in a company? That fatwa said, we're going to allow some impurity or variance. If there's not too much interest or not too much bad stuff, we're going to let you buy the share of stock. You have to figure out what portion of the income of the company or your dividend is attributable to impure sources and give it away to charity. And so you have this huge exercise. Well, those principles of permissible, what I call permissible impurity, which the scholars would prefer I call permissible variance, are everywhere in this industry at this point. If you're going to buy a piece of real estate, to take your example, the first variant principle was we wanted to buy an office building that had, and I don't remember the bank, let's say pick on Citibank, it had an ATM of an interest-based bank on the ground floor. Can you buy that building? Before 98, the answer was no. After 98, they said, well, it's an insignificant portion of the income. It's a little tiny space. They don't do any lending. Well, what about supermarkets that sell pork or alcohol? You know, et cetera. This goes on and on and on with all these principles. Every day of my life, I deal with one of those. So the most interesting one, I'm not sorry to ramble on, but we bought a series of 11 buildings in Indiana, outside Indianapolis. There were only three non-compliant businesses in there. When you buy a building in a piece of real estate, you have to do the Sharia compliant analysis before you buy the building. It's part of the due diligence. Okay, so one of them was a microbrewery. Well, this is about as bad as it gets. Now, so we got turned down. The Sharia board wouldn't let us buy any of the buildings, and the seller would only sell the 11 together. So we went back, and we did transportation studies. There were only three restaurants within, how long does somebody have for lunch to drive an hour? 1 hour. You get to go, eat, and get back. And we did all these studies to determine that there are only three restaurants that people could eat at. One of them is a microbrewery. So how do we isolate out how much profit comes from brewing alcohol and selling alcohol and how much from food? This can get more complex than you can imagine. Eventually, and so we go to trade associations because, of course, that individual company isn't going to tell us. And we eventually figured out what one of the things we figured out, by the way, is that in England, people drink four times or more at lunch as they do in the U.S. But, I mean, you can start to study. Well, they eventually let us buy this, and we decided we erred on this. We give all of the profit from that lease away. And we've taken some steps, but it's a good restaurant. So are these people that administer this, are they, you know, dogmatic about it? No, they aren't. They want the industry to develop, and they seek ways in which to try and allow it to happen. So there's variance in addition on each one of the principles. Over time, you have to cut it back. And there are areas where they're cutting it back. But this is, look, modern Islamic finance only began in 1996. It's a 1,400-year-old system, but, you know, the Brits and the Americans did a very effective job of driving it out of existence for hundreds of years. And it only began, the banking began in the 70s. This began in 1996. This is an infant industry. But anyway, that answers part of your question.
All right. Well, as I mentioned before, we could Fox is looking at me and glancing at his watch, and I think there's lunch.
There is lunch.
And there's lunch. So so I want to say thanks to our panelists. This has been a great opportunity for me to meet them and ask them all my questions. I've got a lot more, though, actually, and I think you may, too. And thank all of you for coming. It's really been great. So I guess we go off to lunch, and thanks again for everything.